Dave Ski here, captain of the Skyber at Skyber. Group economics right on your phone. After soaking up gain from Flex, please check out the wealth management Tudor Bismarck preach from the CBC. After watching that, you'll get it 100% of what we're doing. Search Skyber Service, Google Play, App Store, Skyber. Learn how to trick out the app to get indie music publishing. Discounts for your own ads, Forex indicators.
Skyber's for us, by us.
You know what I'm saying? So it's time to come up, baby.
Skyber!
Word up.
Players, get your hustle on. Oh, yeah.
Skyber.org. Are you tired of being overcharged and forced into paying a monthly subscription for your Mac and Windows software? Well, if you are, currently we're having a 50% off discount on all the latest Mac and Windows software, such as AutoCAD, SolidWorks, Photoshop, Microsoft Office, and much more. Our 50% off discount will be ending soon, so be sure to text us, ready to buy, to the number on the screen. Starting pricing for low-end software, $100, and starting pricing for high-end software, $500. We aim to please, so expect 24/7 technical support, the latest premium software, instant software links delivered to your email, and PayPal Buyer's Protection Guarantee.
What's up, family? This is Curtis G with Passive Income University. Have you been trying to figure out the stock market and investing on your own? Do you need more resources to help you build financial security for your family? PIU has daily content on stocks, investing, real estate, and more. We have a wide range of finance videos so you can learn at your own pace. In addition, we have live webinars to answer your questions in real time. Passive Income University. Join today at www.piuniversity.net.
From the culture of the American South, where roots hold stories, comes a natural deodorant inspired by generations of wisdom. Introducing Rootwork, the all-natural, foundational, Black American-based deodorant infused with the magic of Haijon the Conqueror root. Our unique blend, enriched with this legendary root, offers 24-hour protection, rooted in the power of nature. Embrace this deodorant that celebrates culture, history, and your well-being. Unlock the magic of Rootwork today. Experience the pure essence of nature. Visit rootworkstyle.com and make the switch to a healthier cultural choice.
Boom, there it is. What's going on, guys? I'm here. I am here. All right, what's going on, guys? Welcome to the live broadcast. We are here. Ready to do our thing. Shout out to everybody in the room just getting everything together, throwing stuff all on social media. You know how we get down. Letting everybody get in the room. I need everybody to retweet this, repost this, put this on your social media, ladies and gentlemen. Let everybody know that we are live right now. I'm throwing some stuff on social media as we speak. So let me get that good retweet, ladies and gentlemen. Hold on 1 second. I'm getting it popping. Right. Y'all bear with me 1 second. All right, I'm just throwing stuff all on social media. What's up, Londa? How y'all doing, man? We're here. Glad to have everybody tuning in. Welcome. We're going to chop up a lot of good game today, as we always do. Got my other microphone check shirt on. Ladies and gentlemen, if a lot of folks asking about the microphone check shirts, you can get this at microphonecheck.com. Why am I sweaty in there? Microphonecheck.com. I'll put my arm down. It's kind of hot in here. I'm sweaty in here. I don't want to show my arm sweating. But yeah, microphonecheck.com, ladies and gentlemen. Microphonecheck.com. That's where you can get these microphone check shirts. Also, you can contribute to the film, Microphone Check, microphonecheck.com at the Kickstarter. We are, let me show you guys where we are with the Kickstarter, ladies and gentlemen. Let me show you guys where we are with the Kickstarter. We're doing good. We need to get over that hump. We're at 82K, which is great, with 15 days to go, trying to get to a buck 80. Trying to get to a buck 80. We got 15 days to go, ladies and gentlemen. Can we knock it out for this historic project? Everybody, if you're listening now, let's hit that page now and let's hit that goal. We should be able to hit that goal, bam, just like that. We should be able to knock that right on out, family, because microphone check is a very important piece. You dig? Yeah, I need some root work for my pits. Yeah, I need to put some root work under here to dry that up. Yeah. But yeah, didn't it get hot as hell out here today? Out here in California, it got extra hot. Day. You hear my air conditioning in the back. That's why, you know, normally you don't hear no extra noise in here. But it got real hot out here all of a sudden. Yeah, it got very hot out here all of a sudden. Yeah. But listen, a lot of stuff we got to touch on. A lot of stuff we got to touch on. What's going on with the folks over at the Breakfast Club? I don't know what's going on with DJ Envy. I heard there was some kind of raid up there. Is that true? I don't know the ins and outs, but I heard up there at the Breakfast Club radio station up there, they raided somebody. I know they're investigating DJ Envy for some kind of real estate fraud. I don't know the details of it, but I hope they get through that. I hope those cats up there work that out. I don't want to see anybody get hemmed up. I don't want to see anybody get hemmed up. So yeah, I hope that gets worked out. That, you know, that would be a bad look for that brand. Yeah, it was some kind of real estate RICO. Say somebody said it was some non-FBA scamming. Man. Oh, man, hopefully they get it together, man. I don't want to see that brand get stained by something weird, yeah? So, yeah, hopefully Envy works it out. Somebody said there's a whole bunch of non-FBA and some non-FBA Ponzi scheme stuff. Hey, man, I hope they work it out. They got his partner. Uh-oh. Oh, Lord. Man. Uh-oh. So y'all saying that Envy is going to turn into Gunna? Uh-oh. Man. So hopefully everything will turn out all right with those guys, man. You know, I don't want to see anything janky happen to them. I don't want to see that. But I digress. So what we're talking about today, let's get right into what we're talking about. Today's topic, we're going into the Jada thing. Jada Pinkett, you know, Jada Pinkett is going on a press run. She's promoting her book. I actually got the book. I should have brought it in here. The book is pretty good so far. Pretty good book, not gonna lie. Pretty good book. She talks about how she met Tupac and, you know, I can see where a lot of people feel a certain way. All right? There's a lot of backlash for Jada. Jada's going around talking about her book and telling her story. Now, remember, Will Smith, about, what, a year or so ago, he put his book out. He went on a press tour. You know, there was no backlash. I don't think Will was putting any of the family's personal business out. But I didn't read the book, so I don't know. I didn't read Will's book, so to be honest, I don't know. Yeah, she wrote a book. And the book is good from what I've read. From what I'm reading, it's pretty good. Somebody said the book is full of lies. There's a couple of things that I found kind of problematic. And again, I'm just kind of scheming through it. Skimming through it. She got into some feminist stuff about when she was hanging out with Pac and learning about the Black Power movement and how the black men didn't want to elevate the black women. I'm like, oh, Lord. That kind of rubbed me a little, you know, that got me a little sideways right there. I didn't like that. But again, I got to read everything in the right context. But yeah, it got into some feminist babble about how black men don't be elevating the black women in the black power movement. Okay. All right. Somebody says she's lying throughout the book. So, again, yeah, that one kind of, but listen, why is a lot of the backlash? Why so much of the backlash with Jada? There's a lot of people who just mad at Jada. There's a lot of people who are like, she needs to sit her ass down. There's a lot of folks like, hey, man, we ain't trying to hear all that. A lot of people are kind of cross-referencing her narratives, like she said Tupac proposed to her, and then there were some people saying, hey, well, Tupac was already engaged to somebody at the time. She said she went to visit Tupac at Rikers on such and such date, and then people are cross-referencing saying no, because Tupac was moved to Dannemora, that other prison, at that time, so he wasn't even in Rikers. So there's a lot of cross-referencings of information that she's putting out. Somebody said something about Suge Knight. I think she said Suge Knight gave her Tupac's ashes. And there's some other people saying that's not true. There might be some other stuff going on there. Man, hold on. People said they want you to have to put on dress in the curtain, put them on. Okay, call on camera. Hold on 1 second. Somebody's sending me something. Hold on. Somebody, my brother Devin just sent me something out here. There's something going on out here at a daycare where this guy, brother, went to pick his kid up from a daycare, these white women, and they had his son in a damn dress. They're doing some kind of Halloween thing and put his son in a damn dress. Hold on. Okay, hold on. Let me show y'all this. My brother Devin just showed me this. Hold on, I gotta show y'all this. Let me show y'all. Let me show y'all this. I just got this, man. Shout out to my brother Devin. Let me share this with y'all real quick, man. Y'all bear with me. Let me show y'all this. All right, hold on. Let me share this with you guys. Hold on. Now this is. Hold on. I gotta share this, and this is hot off the presses. This is very hot off the presses right now. Let me see, how can I put it up here? All right, let me try this. Hold on, y'all bear with me for a second. All right, let me put this up real quick. Sorry, guys. Y'all bear with me for a minute. Let me throw this up. All right, hold on. I haven't seen the whole thing myself, but here it is. Hold on.
Let that be the first and last time I see you do that, please.
Hold on, how can I take that off
immediately.
Here, I'll help you.
They get up, they get up.
And you guys, never ever let my son put a dress on, ever.
Okay.
Ever. Let that be the first and last time I see you do that, please. Take that off. Take that off immediately.
Here, I'll help you.
They get up.
And you guys, never ever let my son put a dress on, ever.
Okay.
Ever. Do you understand me? Like ever.
No worries. You gotta do that.
First time and last time.
Yeah, first time and last
ever,
time.
Ever.
Going through technical difficulties while I'm live.
It's just like, oh.
My father.
Hold on, damn, man. Okay. Hold on, man. I want to show this. Oh, man. I don't know. Okay, I just have to do it later, man. I just got to do it later. So they had this kid in it. Hold on. I'm trying to show it. Hold on.
Let that be the first and last time I see you do that, please. Take that off immediately.
Hold on. Okay, so I'm looking at it.
Okay. Ever.
Okay. Ever. Okay, let me play it again. Let me play this again. I'm just going to play the sideways version of it.
Let that be the first and last time I see you do that, please. Take that off. Take that off immediately.
Oh, here. I'll help you. Okay.
They get up.
And you guys never ever let my son put a dress on. Ever.
Okay.
Ever.
Yeah,
you understand me?
Like ever.
Yeah. No problem. No worries. You guys gotta do that.
First time and last time.
Yeah, first time and last
ever.
Real goddamn talk, man.
He says like, oh,
my father.
Yeah, man. I might when I get off this phone, I might have to give them a little call, man. You understand me? All right. I'm sorry it was sideways. Shout out to that. There's some my folks out here, man. I might have to give that little facility a call. We're not going to play that little buck-breaking game, dude. Fuck out of here with that. They're going to try to buck-break these kids early. Man, I'm telling you, out here, dude, shout out to that father. Yeah, and that looks like the only black child in there. Man, see, we got to watch what happens when we leave our kids' places, man. And listen. And those were some white Latinos in there, by the way, too. Hold on. In fact, let me give y'all the name. Let me give the family the name of this place. The Sherman Oaks Lutheran Children's Center. All right? The Sherman Oaks Lutheran Children's Center. That's the name of the place. We're not going to do that. Man, I'm telling you, out here in California, it's real funny style, boy. The agendas that they have out here, they double down out here. They try to get our kids early. I told y'all, these schools out here, when they go on little trips or when they do little things, man, you have to debrief your children when they come home. You understand? You have to debrief your children when your kids come home. These kids will target your babies early and try to buck break them and confuse them. They know exactly what they were doing, putting a dress on that little boy. They know exactly what they were doing putting a dress on that little boy. That's in Sherman Oaks. You understand? We ain't playing that game, man. No. We're not going to do that. This is why, man, we got to be on top of this stuff out here. We got to be on top of everything, man. I told y'all before, my kids went on a school field trip and it seemed innocent. They went to see Cinderella. And, you know, knowing how they get down, I like to just, you know, they make something seem innocent. Oh, we went to see Cinderella and the kids loved it. So my lady just happened to look at the program for the Cinderella play. And we looked down and saw the cast and crew. And we're looking at the names and the fairy godmother was played by a dude. I said, oh, there it is. Uh-oh. Wait a minute. Let me go talk to the kids and let them know, hey, I don't know what you saw, but, you know, don't let these people confuse you with all this stuff. Yeah? While they put a dress on them. You know why they put a dress on them? They're using Halloween, and we got to be careful around this time of year, family, because they'll try to use Halloween as the justification to put a costume and a dress on a black boy. You understand? They'll try to use, well, it's just a Halloween costume. We dressed him as a fairy godmother. We dressed him as Frozen. We have to let them know that type of shit ain't cool. You understand? We got to press these folks to let them know you're not going to be doing this to our kids. We got to be alert, family. Yeah, notice the white boy didn't have a dress on him. They like to do these weird little experiments on black kids. Did y'all see Madonna? Hold on, let me show y'all something. Speaking of experiments on black kids, hold on. Hold on. Madonna was trying to do the Beyonce Blue Ivy thing. Madonna was trying to bite off Beyonce and Blue Ivy. So she, hold on. So Madonna is on tour. So she has her black adopted daughter. Now, is this a girl or is it one of these kids that they done transitioned? Because with these white people adopting these kids, you don't know what's what. They say daughter, but it's really the son, and they had made the kids put on a dress. You never know what's going on with them. So Madonna is trying to bite off Beyonce and Blue Ivy. So Madonna had her daughter, and I'm not sure if this is a biological, not biological, but if this is a girl or a boy, I don't know. It's a black child. So Madonna has this child dancing on stage with her. The child has on a sexualized, skin-tight cat suit and some high-heeled boots. Now notice when Beyonce had Blue Ivy on stage, Blue Ivy was child appropriate. Blue Ivy wasn't trying to be sexualized or overly adultified. So yeah, it might be a son that she's now calling a daughter, I don't know. But the child was doing one of these dances. The child was doing the dances that they, the gay Vogue thing. All right. So this is Madonna. Hold on. Where we at? What the hell? Where are we? Hold on. All right. So this is the child. I think this kid is 11. I don't know. But hold on. All right, I got the sound down. So that's Madonna up there with this black child being overly sexualized. In some damn high heels and a cat suit. Now, I don't know if it's the girl or boy, I don't know. I know that one boy right there in the coat, he's flaming. So, family. We got to watch what's going on out here, man. We really got to watch what's going on out here. That's not it, man. So she saw Beyonce out there with her daughter, so she's like, let me double up on that and take it somewhere to a filthy place. Now again, notice Beyonce had the wherewithal to bring her daughter out, and not once. Blue Ivy had different wardrobe changes all over the country. Not one of those outfits were overly sexual. None of them were age inappropriate. Everything looked great, and the child did a great job. Blue Ivy was in a child's place. They didn't exploit that baby, and it came off great. But boy, we let these other non-black people get around our children or black children, and they always take it somewhere sick. Yeah? But I digress. But listen. All right. But going back to Jada. Shout out to everybody in here. We got a lot of people listening right now. Shout out to everybody listening and folks asking about the Microphone Check shirt. You can go to microphonecheck.com and get the shirt. And while you're on the Microphone Check website, hit the Kickstarter link, ladies and gentlemen, because we're still trying to reach our goal for the documentary film Microphone Check, ladies and gentlemen. But going back to Jada Pinkett, I think the reason why, there's a few reasons why there's a lot of backlash with Jada. It's real extra. A lot of people just across the board, they're like, hey, men and women. You understand? There's men and women looking at Jada real sideways. A lot of folks are like, Jada just need to sit down somewhere. Jada's just, she's doing the most. She's doing too much. Here's the issue. These are the main three issues that people really have with Jada. This is why there's a lot of Jada hate. There's three reasons for it. Reason number one. Jada is kind of coming off very passive aggressively. Doing little things by showing videos of Tupac, and people understand, and even Will has said, the whole Tupac love thing, that kind of bothers him. He's admitted that that kind of bothers him. He's kind of jealous of that. And to have a married woman just constantly do that, bringing up Tupac all the time, and even in the book, just whole chapters about Tupac, and you know, it comes across very passive aggressive. And people feel a certain way about passive aggressive energy. The second thing, family, the reason why people have a problem with Jada is because Jada, for a long time, she was kind of coming across as a spiritual guru to a certain degree. A very Zen, spiritual advisor. She was kind of giving off that energy. Well, I'm going to come down to the red table talk so I can heal you. The head is bald, so she's like a Buddhist monk. Everybody come, you're going to need to redeem yourself at the red table talk. Come have a red table talk with me. Come get some of my sage advice. You think it was kind of that vibe. She's kind of, a lot of people felt she was giving a almost a holier than thou vibe, when behind the scenes, your whole thing is in shambles, right? She was kind of giving an herbal tea vibe, and Liz, come speak with me. Come converse with me and let me show you the way of the world. Let me guide you down the right path. It was that type of thing. And, you know, her shit was in shambles behind the scenes. So people feel a certain way about that. She was kind of giving the spiritual healer vibe. She was kind of giving the oracle vibe, like she was in the Matrix. She was still doing the Matrix thing. She's being the the futuristic oracle, you know? And now we see everything is not so gravy in the relationship. All right? It's like, come to mother. Let me show you how to heal yourselves. You know, that type of thing. And the third thing, which is most important, this is what really throws people off. And this is what you can't come back from. Let me tell you something. When a married woman, no matter if you're separated or not, when a married woman has been confirmed to be out here getting some side dick, you can't come back from that. That's really the thing that throws everybody off, ma'am. They're like, you can't come around giving us advice and you had all types of side dick all up in the house. You can't come back from that as a woman. Now, some people say, oh, double standard. Men be having side chicks and whoop-de-whoop. It's different with the women. Because people look at a woman who's married with some side dick as a person who cannot be trusted. They look at that person as not being loyal. You think? No matter how you cut it, other women can't trust you. Dudes can't trust you. Yeah, the entanglement thing, that really blew up the spot. Can't be trusted. People look at a person, a woman, dudes are different, but with a woman getting side pipe. Now, I think there's some other stuff going on. Me personally, I think there's another kind of arrangement going on. So that's why I can understand, but I'm looking at it differently. But generally, the general public, they see one thing. Married woman getting side pipe can't be trusted. Okay? So that's why there's a lot of Jada hate out here. But I'm not trying to beat up on Jada. Go get the book. I think the book is very good. I think the book is very good, ladies and gentlemen. And yeah, it's an open marriage, all right. But what's open? mouth, bussy, what's all open? See, that's the question. When we hear about these open marriages, what's being open? You're not telling everything. Y'all, I done said this before in Hollywood, when you see some of these people come out and be like, yeah, me and my mate, we understand each other, we got an open marriage. When they say that, it's not what you think it is. Y'all think, well, yeah, we got an open relationship where the dude can just bring women in or whatever. No. A lot of times when they say they got an open relationship, there's some bussy stains somewhere on somebody's hotel pillows. Huh? When they say open, it's like, hey, when you want to get you a little touch of bussy, you know, I turn a blind eye to it. It ain't? Man. But I digress, ladies and gentlemen. I digress. But listen, a lot of stuff going on here, ladies and gentlemen. Right now, we're campaigning heavy to get our reparations. We're working behind the scenes. A lot of the political parties are reaching out to the grassroots. I talked about this the other day. Right now, they understand that the black vote is wide open. People are very disgruntled about the Democrats. The Democrats are struggling right now. The black vote is wide open. And you have a lot of people trying to run game and finesse us into just voting without getting any tangibles, and we're not going to go for it. And people are using all types of deceptive tactics. They're going among us saying all types of slick stuff. I saw something where the head of the NAACP was up here doing a speech in Detroit. And this Sambo was trying to call foundational black Americans, trying to say that we too were immigrants because we were moving from the South to the North. So we are immigrants too. Family, do y'all know the level of horse crap that is? Let me play that clip. Y'all got to hear this. Do y'all know the level of horse crap that is, ladies and gentlemen? Hold on 1 second. Y'all got to hear this. Now, this is the audio. Hold on, listen to this. Hold on.
Some of you understand what I'm talking about, and you don't. Let me put it this way. No one chooses where they are born, to whom, what family, what region of the globe, or what community, and they should have the right to survive.
Okay. Now listen, because this guy knows that there's a major backlash from the black community, all these immigrants they're throwing on us. See, that's why the Democrats are losing. The Democrats are in trouble because we're getting flooded with all these immigrants, and the black community is like, hey, damn, what's up? So they're sending their Negro whisperers out to tell us that we're just like them. Well, everybody has a right to do good in life. You do good back home. The hell they got to do with us? So they done got some instructions from the DNC to get their Negro whisperers to try to compare us to immigrants, like we're the same. All right, so that's why they're going, they got this Negro trying to make it seem like we're like immigrants. Horse crap. Hold on. Hold on. Bear with me. Where we at? Hold on.
They should have the right to survive.
I grew up in Detroit, as we said earlier, and I love my community. It was a beautiful community. It was a community of immigrants. Folks immigrated from Alabama. They immigrated from Mississippi. They immigrated from Arkansas. They immigrated from Georgia. A community of immigrants.
That's not no damn immigrants, fool.
Fleeing hostile territories where they were being oppressed and denied opportunity to work for a fair wage for their labor. Fleeing persecution because of the color of their skin.
No. No, no, no. No, nigga, no. Do y'all hear this horse crap? Let me stop some of it. Hold on. We're not, that's not immigration. You're not immigrating when you move to another part of a country where you are a taxpayer. That's not immigration. We didn't have to go through an administrative process to move to the north. That's not an immigrant. We're moving to places where we're still constitutionally citizens. We're exercising our rights as citizens. We're already citizens. To move to other parts of a country that we're already citizens of, that ain't immigration. These folks are desperate with the damn lies. You're just moving to another part of a country that you pay taxes, that you built. We built the entire country, and we're citizens of the country. That's different from somebody coming from a whole different government with a different constitution, having to go through an administrative paperwork process in order to come over. That's completely different. This is our country. We have a right to go to these places constitutionally because as foundational Black Americans, we fought for those rights. We fought for the 14th and 13th Amendment. We fought for that. To be allowed to enjoy the constitutional rights of everybody born on this land. We're exercising something we already fought for, dude. Don't compare us to people who fled their homeland and didn't fix it. And another thing, come on, we're fleeing persecution. When did we flee persecution? There was racism in the North. We didn't flee persecution. The North wasn't persecution free. The West wasn't persecution free. We still had racism in the damn North. All of the race riots were really going on in the North and the West. He's in Detroit. Detroit had two major race riots. 1943, 1967. What is this Negro talking about? Most of the sundown towns were in the damn North, where Black folks couldn't go after 6 o'clock. Most of that was in the North. We didn't flee anything. We just moved somewhere where there were better jobs. So we're like, if we're gonna be under the thumb of white supremacy, at least let's go somewhere where we're gonna make a decent living. We were dealing with racism in the South. Wasn't no jobs like that down there. We started moving to the North when, notice two waves, the two migrations. There were two migrations, and that was a job migration. Wasn't no fleeing persecution. We moved to the North two waves, right around World War I and World War II. Got it? World War I, they stopped having to let these immigrants over because of the World War. You couldn't let these hostile immigrants come over from some of these countries that we were beefing with. So those jobs were open. Hey, we're gonna go up there and get them jobs. The post-war industry after World War II, there were a lot of jobs created. We said, hey, let's go to Detroit, Ohio, New York. Let's go up there and get some of them jobs. The job markets opened up. That was job opportunities that was opening up, and we went and took advantage of those job opportunities. Wasn't fleeing persecution. We had persecution in the North. Remember, when all those Black people were in the North, there were race riots in Jersey, Philly, Detroit, Ohio, all in New York. Dude, do you know how many sundown towns are in the state of Illinois? When we think of Illinois, we think of Chicago, which is a lot of Black folks there. There's parts, man, they got a place called Anna, Illinois. Man, the Anna stood for Ain't No Niggas Allowed because they had a sundown bell. Yeah, Anna, Illinois. They had a bell that they would ring at 6 o'clock, meaning that all the black people had to be off the streets at six. They had to ring a bell. And they say they still got the bell up there. You had hardcore sundown towns up there. You had sundown towns here in California. Glendale was a sundown town. Hawthorne was a sundown town. Yeah? Don't let these people fool you talking about we were fleeing persecution like these immigrants fleeing from their homeland. No, we were just going where the jobs were, and we were fighting in the South. We were fighting in the North. We never fled from our constitutionally protected areas or areas that's supposed to protect us constitutionally. The areas that we built, the land that we built, the land that we cultivated and made great, we never fled from that. So shame on that Sambo for trying to compare us to foreign immigrants. That ain't the same at all. Hold on. Let me play some more of this fool. Hold on.
Well, y'all thought I was a Latino, we're talking about black folks. Now look around this room, all of us are immigrants.
No, we're not.
You think about it. Look at your family history. Most of you are second, third, and some are fourth and fifth generation who migrated either during the Great Migration 1 or Great Migration 2. Immigrants.
No, fool.
Others who immigrated from other countries because of persecutions and failed governments and issues that caused them to have to leave from the place of their ancestral birth to come here because it was said there were opportunities and or safety. Immigrants.
We didn't get no safety.
Others of you who come from some European country because of persecution, whether it's based on religion or lack of opportunity, and you came here because your ancestors or your immediate parents seeking opportunity. Immigrants. Opportunities that was guaranteed under this thing we call a constitution that we know as a social contract. But that contract is only as good as the individuals who are in office to ensure it is provided.
Okay, that's enough of this horse crap. Dude, you better stop. This is how desperate they are because they got all these immigrants flooding in. They know they can't use the word minority no more. They can't use these little trick-ass words. So now they're going to try this whole immigrant thing that we're all immigrants. Man, you out of your damn mind. The Democrats are shameless with their nonsensical rhetoric. We are not immigrants in any shape, way, form, or fashion. In fact, most of us stayed in the South. Most of us go back and forth to the South. Boy, that's a long reach. The hell you talking about immigrant, dude? Most of us go back and forth to the South. That's not an immigrant. You're moving back and forth in a land that is your own land that you're a citizen of. That's why we would have family reunions. That's why we would go back and forth. I was born in Detroit, but then I was raised down in Alabama. We went back and forth. Then I would go back to Detroit in the summertime, stay with my aunt, and then go back to Alabama. Went back and forth. Nobody immigrated nowhere. Didn't immigrate no damn where. We went back and forth, and I'm a product of going back and forth from the North and the South, the North and the South. You dig? That's why I don't have a Southern accent. Y'all hear me talk. I don't have a Southern accent because I would go back and forth. I was raised in the South, but born in the North, and I would go back and forth, which a lot of us did. We ain't no damn immigrants. How dare you insult us like that? Man, we stayed 10 toes down. We fought in the South. We fought in the North. We stay and fight, dude. We had to whoop ass in the North just like we did in the South. We had to whoop more ass in the North. Don't you dare put us in that category. We didn't switch governments. We stayed 10 toes down to face this same oppressive government. When they attacked us, they sent the same National Guard in the South that they sent in the North. They sent the same National Guard to come and try to suppress us. The hell are you talking about? Running from persecution. It's the same National Guard. The same National Guard in the North. The same National Guard out here in the Watts riots. We've had to deal with the exact same oppressive force. We didn't flee from that. We stayed 10 toes down and we dealt with it everywhere we went. We didn't escape that. Come on, escaping persecution. What persecution did we escape? And it's the same National Guard y'all try to sick on us every time. Same uniform under the same constitution. What damn persecution did we escape or flee from? We're the only ones that stand 10 toes down in front of it. We don't run. Don't dare put us in the category of somebody who ran. I'm insulted by that. We didn't flee nothing. The fuck you talking about? Don't you dare put us in that category. We didn't get no sanctuary, man. We're making it seem like we went somewhere where somebody was protecting us from something. No. See, other groups, let's keep it clear. When other groups from other countries come here, we're protecting them. See, they get to hide behind us while we do all the fighting. They're the ones who get protection from us. You get to go hide and get all the benefits while we get all knocked and bruised up, while you hide behind us. We didn't hide. We don't have nobody to hide behind. Don't make it seem like we went somewhere and somebody, some shadowy figure, was protecting us from something. Who, nigga? Who was protecting us from persecution? If we were escaping persecution, who protected us? Who? Nobody. We did. We had to protect ourselves everywhere we went. Don't you dare compare us to no damn immigrant groups. Man, please. It's a lot of nerve. And that's another thing. See, that's why we got to get that hip-hop thing straight, too. Because when we look at hip-hop, and this is why this documentary we're doing is very important, and this is why I take so offense to this Latinos and blacks was doing it 50-50. That's why that's so offensive to me. And let me show y'all something. Listen, they're desperately going with that narrative. I mean, they're pushing that narrative so hard. There's a corporate push for that narrative. There's an Amazon movie that had Fat Joe and all of these people talking about how blacks and Latinos created hip hop. Now, Paramount Plus, they got a documentary coming out next month, or probably later this month. What's it called? Hold on. Called De La Cali. De La Cali or something like that. Hold on. They got this documentary. I don't even want to show the trailer. I'm just going to show y'all this. Talking about, listen, this is the premise of it. So they're going to have rappers in it, but hold on. Okay.
Hold on. Into your heart.
Okay. Okay, that's DJ Charlie Chase. Now hold on. Journey into the Latino diaspora to map the evolution of Urbano music and explore the cultures that ignited the musical revolution of hip hop, rap, reggaeton, Latin trap, cumbia, and others. If you don't go to hell. Family, I told y'all this is where it's going. They're trying to say that hip hop was ignited from Latino culture. I'm telling you, that's all that 50-50 nonsense. It's going to go beyond just 50. If we let them get away with the 50-50 lie, then it's going to go into, well, y'all kind of got it from us. That's where it's going. They're trying to finagle the lie that it came from the Caribbean and Latin America, and they somehow gave it to us. I'm telling y'all, they got a blank check to put this nonsense out. which is a lie. This is why microphone check is so very important, family. These folks are getting an endless supply of resources from the white corporate structure to put these lies out, family. That's why with microphone check, we should have been at that 180 a long time ago, family. Family, with on our Kickstarter, we should have been at that 180 a long time ago. All we're trying to get is 180. We should have been at that a long time ago. This is what we're up against. We're up against people throwing tens of millions of dollars to push this damn lie that we're somehow got our culture from somebody else. They're trying to literally erase us from it. You feel me? And this is why they've been having a hissy fit over the microphone check film. This is why they're having a hissy fit over it. These folks know that they did not have anything to do with the creation of hip-hop at all. What are the elements of hip-hop? All of the elements of hip-hop were created by Foundation of Black Americans. Every single element. These folks are up here trying to say that they created the rock and dance. What's up, Derek Cologne? I know you're watching. Y'all created the rock and dance, and the rock and dance morphed into the break dance, and everybody got it in b-boying. Hip hop started with b-boying. No. Hip hop started with block parties and funk music and people getting down on the breakdown. That's where hip hop starts. Hip hop starts at black people doing street dances on the breakdown of records. That's the basis of hip hop. When you say b-boying, that's another euphemism for street dancing. Street dancing comes from foundational black Americans. When you look at the elements of hip hop, let's get down with this thing. The five elements: DJing, MCing, graffiti, b-boying, and knowledge. When you use the term b-boying, that's another euphemism for basically street dancing, because we still have hip-hop now. Hip-hop is still alive now. You have hip-hop events. You have rap clubs and clubs that play hip-hop music. It's still hip-hop. People are not spinning around on the floor. They're not breakdancing in the traditional sense of doing floor moves, but they're doing street dances. The street dances, that's the thing that makes it hip-hop. The street dances on the breakdown of a record. And the whole record is basically a breakdown at this point. You're emphasizing the beat. Urban dancing, street dancing, which comes from foundational black Americans. You understand? And let's be clear, all of those elements come from us. And the turntablisms, to be honest, that started coming from the DJs out of Brooklyn first. And other DJs started to emulate what the DJs in Brooklyn were doing, and then they added on to it. But let's be clear, you had DJs in Brooklyn, late 60s, early 70s, like Flowers. Flowers was the man. Grandmaster Flowers, who the person Grandmaster Flash got his name from, and a lot of people dismiss Flowers for saying he's a disco DJ. They kind of dismiss those guys, but we got to understand, a lot of these dudes laid the foundation and the framework to what would become hip-hop, and in a sense, they were hip-hop, but hip-hop at the time wasn't clearly defined as we define it now. But that doesn't mean that it didn't exist. I'm telling people, and a lot of people have said, even Herc and Bambaataa, they'll start talking about where hip-hop really started in 1970. Some people even say 67. You understand? Because a lot of the elements were pretty much there in 67. Most definitely, I would say, yes, the elements were absolutely there in 67. By 69, hip hop as a culture was already here by 1969. Because that's when you had the rise of the knowledge aspect, and the knowledge aspect is very important. the slang and the dances and the graffiti, everything was completely in place by 69, and the knowledge aspect. Where did the knowledge come from? You understand? The knowledge came from the black people and the black power movement and the black people understanding that they have to do for self. They have to understand they have to be anti-establishment because the establishment was decidedly anti-black. So what everybody was doing as it relates to hip hop was going against the establishment. You understand? Everybody in hip hop, what they were doing, all the elements were put together because they were going against what the establishment was doing. Yeah? Yeah, a lot of people dismiss Flowers because, see, Flowers, he was a top DJ, and there were a lot of other DJs, Flowers, Pete, DJ Jones, you know, they catered to an older crowd, but they were still hip-hop in a sense. Who is this people? Oh, hold on. I get that later. But all the elements were there. There were people rapping on records. By 69, the word rap as it related to rhyming, that was in the lexicon. A lot of the slang was already there. Also, by 69, the rise of the five percenters was very important. You understand? The rise of the five percenters, that was very important as it relates to the early days of hip hop. We discussed that in the new movie. A lot of the slang, the terminology, the gestures, the moves, as you saw in the trailer, we talked about the B-boy stand. But if you really want to get into the up-rocking, if you really want to talk about up-rocking, we were already doing up-rock style dances, the Charleston and the Lindsay hop, we were doing that. But another thing in the 60s that the five percenters were known for and other black people, Foundation of Black Americans, was the 52 block martial arts style. Remember that? The 52 blocks, come on, where are my New York people? You know what the 52 blocks are, the moves of the 52 blocks? That's where a lot of the up-rocking stuff is. You know, the 52 blocks, you're doing these kind of moves. Five percenters were doing that stuff. Yeah? And them five percenters were at those hurt parties. Right? The 52 blocks was doing that. You dig? And 52 blocks, what was the original name of 52 blocks? The original name of 52 Block was called Jailhouse Rock. That's where the rock name, you want to talk about rock. The original name was of 52 Blocks was Jailhouse Rock. Y'all better start putting two and two together with this stuff. The five percenters were very instrumental in early hip hop because they were around Herc. The Zulu Nation took a lot of the tenants of the five percenters. You understand? Let's keep it a buck. Yeah, they called it the Jailhouse Rock. That was the original name of 52 blocks that brothers in New York, in the Bronx and Brooklyn, they were doing in the 1960s and the 70s. All right, we got to put all this stuff together. Let's stop letting these people lie. Talk about we got some shit from them, because again, that goes into the knowledge thing. The knowledge thing is very important. That is an important element, because the brothers and sisters who were creating hip hop, remember, we were creating this stuff because we were not allowed into other sectors of society. We couldn't get into those discos, couldn't get into music schools. We didn't have instruments. We couldn't get tap dancing classes, so we had to do street dances, because when you talk to some of the original B-boys, a lot of them wanted to be tap dancers. You know, they wanted to take classes. They didn't have any money to do that. They saw the Hines brothers and the Mills brothers and the Nicholas brothers. They wanted to do that. So they were like, well, hell, we're going to gravitate towards James Brown. We're going to gravitate towards some of these other, these street dances. So they created their own street dances. You know? We always got it out the mud. And the glue that binded everybody was them understanding that we are in a system of white supremacy, and these elements that we're going to create are anti-white supremacy. Because the white supremacists and their system, they're not going to allow us to get into their system. We're going to create our own. And we're going to create our own rules. We're going to create our own dances and our rules to the dancing. Don't bite nobody's style. Don't bite nobody's rhyme. Come up with a different nickname. We're going to come up with all of our different nicknames. You dig? We were anti-white supremacist establishment. That's why we created hip hop, out of necessity to demonstrate and practice the talent and artistic mindset that we had. We needed an outlet to create or exercise our own artistic talents. Because we couldn't get into that system. Because we had to understand we had to be anti-establishment. The graffiti, that was anti-establishment. Look, we can't go to art school. When our brother Cornbread created modern graffiti, he did it in a damn juvenile facility. He was incarcerated. That's why when you see early graffiti, you see gangs doing it first. But Cornbread was the first one to do it in an artistic fashion. Cornbread was the first person to make graffiti an art form. You can tell people talk about there were people writing on walls. Yeah, cavemen wrote on walls, but Cornbread made it into an urban art form. You turned it into an artistic movement. Yeah? And let me tell you something. Only a foundational Black American who understands building outside of the oppressive system, we are the only ones who could create a system and a culture of white of hip hop, because we were anti-white supremacist establishment. We were the only people who could do that. By definition, because of the five elements, the DJing, b-boying, rapping, graffiti, and knowledge, you gotta have all of those elements. And you gotta understand all those elements. By definition, a Latino person coming over, identifying with the oppressor class, could not have created hip hop. That's why it's asinine when some of these people say that they helped create hip hop. If you are a person under a system of white supremacy, and you white, and you get a piece of paper, and you write your status down as white, meaning you identify with the oppressor class, you cannot be a person who created hip hop. Let me say that again. If you write your name down as white on a piece of paper and you claim to be in an oppressive system, by definition, you could not be a person who created hip hop. Let me say that one more time. If you classify yourself as white, that means you identify with the oppressor class, and by definition, you cannot say that you created anything like hip-hop, because hip-hop was anti-white supremacist establishment. You can't claim ownership of hip-hop. You can't, by definition. That goes against the knowledge aspect. When hip hop was created, brothers was running around here saying the Black man is God. You have the Black Power Movement, the Black Spades. They were getting their names and words from people like H. Rap Brown. That was a Black Power leader. the thing that fueled hip-hop was black power. That was the thing that fueled it. It was black James Brown, I'm black and I'm proud. That was the thing that fueled hip-hop. It was the black power movement. That was the sauce to everything, especially at that time when the black power movement was heavy. Everybody was on, hey, you know what? I'm proud to be black. It's all about blackness. We gonna damn all of that pop music, all of that. It's time to get funky and get down. We were fully embracing our blackness. That's why we had the drums. You know that Derek Cologne is trying to call breakdowns in music? He done made up a term called the Latin breakdown because they had congas in a lot of the breakdown songs in the late 60s, early 70s. That didn't have nothing to do with no damn Latin society. Even when James Brown Give It Up, Turn It Loose, they had congas in there. That was the foundation of Black American playing it, and they were embracing the Africanness of the music. They were infusing some African vibes in there because we were embracing global blackness. Even though it was foundational Black Americans creating it, let's bring some African flavor in here too. Let's go to some African flavor, which the Congos, that's something that we still play. Let's not play no games. That Congo, talking about the Congo is some Latin, no. Dude, we had Congos and drums. They took the drums away from us during slavery. We used our bodies as drums. Going all the way in the 50s, we were doing the ham bone and the patent juba. We always had that percussive thing going on. If we couldn't afford drums, we'd use our bodies. We've always had that percussive thing going on. Y'all not gonna slip something in there. Somebody play a Congo. Oops, there's a Latin thing. They got it from somebody Latin. Who? This fool's running around here talking about a Latin breakdown. Ain't no such thing as a damn Latin breakdown when you have foundational Black Americans doing all the music. Yeah? Come on now. Yeah, Congos were played in early jazz bands too, absolutely. Yeah, we're natural percussionists. Yeah, we can play percussions on our bodies if need be. So that's what beatboxing comes from. We can just start spitting out a beat. We're gonna play a beat, we'll give you a beat. When you look at those Greek fraternities, Greek, quote unquote, which the black fraternities, doing the stepping moves, huh? Them Q dogs and doing all them stepping and doing that's the patent juba. That's the going back to foundational Black Americans using their bodies as drums to send messages. That's where it comes from. Yeah, down in Louisiana, Congo Square. That would go into jazz music. I was just down there in Louisiana, over there in the Treme area where jazz was created. We're phenomenal, dude. Come on, man. All of this is foundational Black American culture. You're not gonna crowbar some other people in some shit we created. We created all of this stuff. Yeah? And this is why we gotta tell our story, ladies and gentlemen. Hold on, let me get it. Got my zapper, getting these bugs, baby. I love my zapper. But family, we have to tell these stories. We have to get these narratives out here, ladies and gentlemen. That's why Microphone Check, man, such a very important film. Such a very important film. We got a lot of people in here. We got a lot of folks in here. Shout out to everybody in here, ladies and gentlemen. But anyway, when we put let me play the trailer for a Microphone Check. For those who haven't seen the trailer, let me play the trailer for the film Microphone Check, and everybody got to get involved with it. Here's the trailer for the film Microphone Check, if you haven't seen it.
It's the 50th anniversary of hip-hop, and we still have a lot of discrepancies as far as the origins of hip-hop, a lot of claims, who did what, who was the first this, who was the this and that, and such and such. But at the end of the day, we need a definitive story, all right? And that story can only be told by the founders of this culture.
Like, everything was being driven and influenced by young, black, American culture. Like, the slang, the style of dress, the initial music that we chose.
Look at all the boroughs. You got, you know, Money Making Manhattan and Money Earning Mount Vernon and Crooklyn. The Bronx was the boogie down Bronx. We was partying up there.
I am Coke LaRock, the first MC of hip hop. First cat to pick the mic up.
I introduced rapping to the turntables because when I came with it, nobody in the world was doing it. I'm right after Rudy Ray Moore.
They want to come in the mix, they want to say, we started. No, you didn't. No, you didn't. What came to be known as hip hop was solely an African American creation.
What would you get out of some Jamaican toast? What is that? I've never heard of a rapper use a Jamaican toast or a Jamaican flu as a rhyme. I've never heard of it, and I don't know where that myth came from.
My name is Legendary. Came Trixie from the Bronx, BX from the West Side. I am the first breakdancer.
That narrative that hip-hop has had three founding fathers, that's been rolling for the last almost 30 years, which isn't true. You don't have just three people who created hip-hop. Hip-hop was created by a number of different people.
I am the grandfather, the godfather of the graffiti culture. I am the first element of hip-hop.
The roots of hip-hop being Jamaican, absolutely false.
My name is MC Sha-Rock. I am a founding member of the MC/rap culture.
Cassette tapes was the internet of our time. It just traveled around by hand.
I know for a fact that the B-boy stance started from the gods, the five percenters that would be at the jams back in the days who were acting as security.
If they get the real truth of how it all was created, then so many lies would not be able to be in existence.
Come on. Boom, there it is. Man, family, this is the most important film of the year. Family, this is the most important film of the year, ladies and gentlemen. Family, there's a reason why these people, Paramount and Amazon, they got so much money that they're throwing at rewriting our history. It's very important for them to get some misinformation out about the culture we created, and it's only going to be us to fix it. It's only going to be us to fix this thing. We got to fix this thing. We're the only ones who are going to be able to do it. We're the only ones who's going to be able to do this thing, man. You dig? It's up to us. And family, they are going for theirs. They got a gazillion dollars. They're just going for it. They're just going to keep lying and lying and lying. And family, this film right here, man, y'all don't... The gravity of the importance of this film. This is a grassroots thing, man. It's always up to the grassroots to rectify these narratives. This is like David and Goliath. The grassroots going against these big media giants, and we can do it. We just have to get on code and just get it knocked out. You understand? Like we always do. Because we're standing on truth and we're standing on righteousness. Yeah? We're standing on truth. We're not supposed to sit up here and let folks, let these demonic-ass people lie and then erase our ancestors and then us from history. We ain't supposed to sit around and let folks do that. And shame on Negroes in the industry, because they're beholden to those corporate white dollars. They're not going to say anything. We're not beholden to them. So that's why we can go ahead and tell the truth, because we're not looking to get any crumbs from them anyway. So we can tell the truth. I'm not looking to get hooked up with none of those corporate entities. No, I'm here with the grassroots, and I'm on truth. We're standing on FBA business. You understand? And we got to stand 10 toes down as a group on that one. Anyway, man, let me get up out of here, man. But anyway, everybody, go to the Kickstarter page. Go to the Kickstarter page, everybody. Let's hit that goal. We got 15 days left. We're working on this movie around the clock. It's coming, and it's coming along great, ladies and gentlemen. Go to microphonecheck.com or go to the Kickstarter link right here. Let's everybody get involved. Let's get us over that hump. We got 15 days. Family, if everybody puts something on this thing now, we can get to where we need to be on it, and we'll be good to go. But anyway, man, much respect to the family. Papi Akute and Lola Vuve to the family. Y'all have a great week. Holla.